Let's get started. Oh, we have fewer people today. Is it the weather effect or is it the weekend effect? Or is it because the lectures are recorded and you can watch them at your convenience? Well, you cannot ask questions over there, right? Yeah, that's right. That's a very good point, actually. That's always a problem. You've got to have the right experimental group to experiment with. In this case, you probably don't know the answer. Okay, we'll continue where we left off from yesterday. And it's very unlikely that we'll get to pipelining today, unless you tell me that you know everything I'm going to talk about in this lecture. How many of you know microprogramming? Good. That's why you're here. This is, I mean, like everything in computer architecture, in my opinion, this is a fascinating topic. Because just like you can program at a higher level, you can program at a lower level also. And hopefully this lecture will enable you to stretch your mind a little bit. The ISA instructions we have at the higher level are actually at a very high level. Underneath, you can have micro-instructions. And we're going to translate those instructions to micro-instructions today, which is done by any microprocessor. That the Intel processor inside here does that micro-programming. Right now, actually, when it's executing instructions. It's basically translating the x86 ISA to an internal ISA that's not visible to anyone else in the world other than the hardware designer. And that internal micro ISA, if you will, micro instruction set architecture, enables the hardware to operate correctly and fast. That's the idea of microprogramming in just 1 second, basically. And here's where we are. And hopefully you're doing the readings, because I think you'll learn the material best if you actually do the readings together with the lectures. And in fact, I'm going to cover a lot of the appendices that I've given readings for you. Let me see. Let me make sure it's organized. This is Appendix A, LC3B ISA. It's a toy ISA, but it's beautifully designed for instruction. And this is Appendix C, which we're going to cover today. That's the micro-programmed micro-architecture for the LC3B ISA. One micro-architecture, of course. But before we get there, let's continue what we started, because in the end I rushed a little bit. I want to go through that a little bit more carefully. Basically, we were talking about multi-cycle micro-architectures, and you know by now that single cycle is very contrived. Nobody used it. I don't think anybody's going to use it in the future, but it's good to build up to multi-cycles with some baby steps. Multi-cycle means that you take multiple cycles to process an instruction. And we've covered a lot. All of this should be very familiar to you at this point. And we've started covering one example, multi-cycle micro-architecture, which is basically we took the single-cycle MIPS processor and we rebuilt it to be multi-cycle. As you look over here, the single cycle doesn't have any registers over here, right? It's the only register is somewhere over here, which is the program counter, actually. I mean, there are other registers, the register file, and also the memory, which is part of the architectural state, this AS over here. But there are no micro-architectural internal registers. And we added those internal registers such that you could do this step and then stop the processing of the instruction, and then you could do the next step in the next cycle, and the next step in the next cycle, and the next step in the next cycle. And these registers were the cost we paid to be able to do things in multiple cycles, right? Everything comes at a cost. Don't forget that. If someone comes with a microarchitecture or a system design and tells you that the benefit doesn't come at a cost, you should always look for the cost, because it's always a trade-off that we're making. And what trade-off you make depends on what you value more or less. Sometimes, of course, some things come at lower cost than higher cost. And in general, we talked about that lower cost mechanisms are the ones that win because they are more easily adopted in the general domain, right? So this was our cost, basically, these additional registers. And this is our control unit. We're going to cover a lot about the control unit today, but let's take a look at this particular control unit. Basically, you give the opcode to this control unit, and you get a bunch of control signals from the main controller. And, of course, the ALU control signals as well, right? And the control signals determine which state you're in, or the state is associated with the control signals. For example, in the fetch state, you need to assert some control signals. And I'm not going to go through this in detail because this is very similar to the single cycle architecture, except only some of the control signals are asserted because we're just fetching the instruction, right? For example, if you look at the I or D control signal, it controls this mux. Basically, it selects whether the address of the instruction or data memory is coming from the program counter or if it's coming from the memory address that's generated by a load instruction. But since we're in the fetch state, we're going to try to fetch the instruction, which means that we want to enable the signal to be zero such that we input the program counter as the address we input to the memory. That makes sense, right? That's why this is the fetch state, because we want to fetch the instruction. And clearly, other control signals need to be enabled similarly. For example, we're not writing to memory. In fact, we're going to read from memory, so that had better be zero. Otherwise, we'll do something wrong in the fetch state. And we want to write to this register, clearly. That's the IR write, because at the end of the state, we want the instruction to be moved into this register and not to this register. Although some of the control signals can be X's, as you can see, basically, because we're not using part of the data path in this fetch state, control signals could be X's, meaning we don't care about that control signal. As long as you don't do damage, it's fine, right? This mux can select either these 5 bits from the instruction register or these 5 bits from the instruction register. As long as we're not going to latch the output over here or write to the register file, we don't care. That's what the don't care is about. And don't cares are good because you can simplify the generation of these control signals potentially, right? Okay, let me see. Also, there's the PC write control signal. At the end of the state, we want to increment the PC, basically, because, again, remember the sequential execution? Every instruction increments the PC, except for branch instructions, but we're in the fetch state right now. We can increment the PC, and if you later figure out that it's a branch instruction, and we need to take the target, or a jump instruction, and we need to take the target, then we can overwrite the PC again in the finite state machine, right? So but this PC write signal is enabled over here, and you can see that it comes from somewhere over here. PC write branch, in this case, branch is zero. Okay, because we don't have an instruction yet. We're in the fetch state. Okay, we're going to go over some more data path later on. Does this make sense to everyone? Okay, good. So decode state, you have some other control signals, and it so happens in this case that we don't have any control signals because this logic control unit over here just generates the control signals. Basically, there's nothing to control over here. Of course, you need to... Well, I guess we do have control signals. I should take that back. Again, you don't need to do damage. You should not do damage, basically. We're not incrementing the PC, for example. We're not writing to memory. We're not writing to, this register. But we're going to write to some other register. I guess this one over here, right? Although you could always write to that register. You may not need a control signal for that. Okay. So after decode, you know whether it's a load or a store, and you can now move to the state. If the instruction is a load word or a store word, you move to this memory address generation state. And there are a bunch of other control signals associated with it. And again, I'm not going to go through this in detail, but these control signals ensure that you generate the right address based on the instruction that you have at hand, right? And do no other damage in the data path. Okay, and then if it's a load, you read the memory. That's the next control signal. In this case, I or D is set to 1. As you can see, I or D, basically, this is the I or D mux. You need to supply the address that's coming from over here, from this ALU out. And that's why if I or D is set to 1, you'd get that address. That's how you can access memory. Okay, and the write back stage for load, basically you write back to the register. And this is the register destination mux. You enable the register to write. If you look at the control signal rec write, there it is, yeah. This needs to be set to 1. I need to get the write register destination, which is 20 to 16 for the loads. It's not always the case, as you know, the MIPS ISA. And also a mem2reg should be one. There's a mem2reg mux somewhere over here, which is this one. Basically, you need to get the data that's coming from the memory. Well, in this case, the memory is over here. Okay, all data paths are different. Right? So you need to get the data that's coming from here, from the data memory to write the destination. Okay, so that's a basic finite state machine. And you need to do this basically for stores. Of course, as we said, you can share the states. You need to do this for R-type operations. After decode, you figure out it's an R-type operation. You go this way. And if it's a branch, you go this way. And now you can see that we've incremented the PC over here, but we're going to, again, write to the PC over there. Okay. So this is the complete multi-cycling controller. It's not complete for MIPS, of course. It's complete for a set of instructions. But you can add, if you want to do add immediate, you can keep adding states, as you can see over here. And if you want to do a jump, you can keep adding other states. Make sense? Is this simple to everyone? No? Okay. Okay. I think this is the complete with the jump instruction. But we're going to see the LC3B state machine also in a different way. So let's look at the performance of this. And again, when data is presented to you, you should always be critical of the data. And I'm going to give you an example of how to be critical of the data over here. We're going to make a bunch of assumptions. As you can see in this case, branches take 3 cycles, right? 1, 2, 3 for this branch, B equal 1, 2, 3 for the jump. R-type store word and add I instructions take 4 cycles, and loads take 5 cycles. I guess loads are the longest instructions over here that take 5 cycles. And we're going to make some assumptions. This is cycles per instruction, the weighted average across some workloads. You always evaluate the design you make with some workloads. And it so happens that in these workloads, you have this fraction of instructions. It's dominated by R-type instructions, 52%. It has 25% loads, dot, 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 right? Now, if you calculate the average cycles per instruction, this is what you get. And assuming those calculations are correct, your average CPI is 4.12. This is clearly 4 times higher than the CPI we get for a single cycle, right? We've increased the CPI. So where did we gain? Yes, we gained, hopefully, in the clock frequency, right? But in order for us to win, we're not going to change the number of instructions, right? Number of instructions is constant. We increase the CPI by 4x. So we'd better get more than 4x improvements in the clock frequency to be better than single-cycle architecture. Okay. And I'm going to show you that we're not going to, in this case, if you do some sort of data path analysis. But before that, I think, let's be critical. Is this... we're assuming a lot of things over here, clearly, right? One of the assumptions is 5 cycles for the load. Really? Is it realistic? I mean, we've discussed this today, yesterday. It's not clear if that's true, right? We're basically assuming that this memory read happens magically in one cycle, right? Well, for that to happen, maybe you need a small memory. But what if you want big memory, right? So keep that in mind, basically. What if this is variable cycles? Will this state machine actually work? If this was a 100 milliseconds, as I gave you the example yesterday, is your clock cycle 100 milliseconds still? Yeah, we're going to get back to it. Okay, let's do the calculation. This is the critical path, and I'm not going to find the critical path over here because it really depends on a lot of assumptions. But basically, you can read the slides in more detail. Basically, you need to go over the setup times and that register clock to queue. And then your critical path goes through one of these things. And it turns out your memory is the bottleneck in this case because it takes the longest. Basically, the memory access state is the bottleneck in this case. So you get 325 picoseconds. I'm not harping on this because it depends on where your critical path is, what numbers you select. But clearly, we selected 325 picoseconds in this case. That's our critical path. We determined that. Well, this is much less than, if you remember, in the single-cycle analysis, we did 925 picoseconds, right? So we got about 3x per improvement. So too bad. We didn't overcome the increase in cycle per instruction. Meaning we got this is the execution time you got with this multi-cycle architecture, 133.9 seconds. With the single cycle, we had 92.5 seconds. So why? Yes? Excellent. That's potentially one reason, right? Did we break the stages in a balanced manner? Maybe we didn't, right? I just gave you an example data path design, and I broke it in arbitrary points. Maybe there are some other points we could break things into. Maybe we could since memory is the bottleneck, maybe we could break that into multiple cycles, right? Clearly we didn't here. We assumed one single state to access memory that completes in one clock cycle, right? So that could be one reason, right? There's also other reasons, like overhead of register setup hold that's paid many times, right? You keep paying it every clock cycle, whereas in a single cycle microarchitecture, you paid only at the end or the beginning or both. But you pay it every cycle in the multi-cycle architecture. And the more states you have to execute an instruction, you increase your overhead linearly, right? So that's another reason. And, of course, we have assumed a bunch of things, right? Maybe the result would have been different with different assumptions of the memory latency and the instruction mix. And I'll talk about the memory latency a little bit. But instruction mix is also very important, right? What if your instruction mix was completely different over here? If you look at this finite state machine, which is granted very limited, right? But if most of your instructions were shorter instructions, maybe you could gain in that case. Because all those shorter instructions take 925 picoseconds in the other architecture. Okay, so these are three reasons. Does anybody have any other reasons? Okay, if you come up with it, you can let me know. But almost always you run into these issues, basically. Whenever you evaluate any microarchitecture, independent of multi-cycle, single cycle, did you do the right thing in your design, basically? Did you create a bottleneck? Remember the balanced design principle? I don't believe this design is balanced, but I'm not going to give you a design that's balanced. It's actually a really hard problem. Companies that design microprocessors face it daily or hourly. How do you balance the design? This overheads, you want to minimize them, and you always want to design for the workload, but workload may be something that you cannot fully predict, right? You design processors today, they're going to execute workloads 10 years, 20 years out. That's why this is partially art, right? We don't know exactly what the workloads are, and we cannot model those workloads also, because that modeling is really modeling the future, including the human progress into the future, right? What kind of workloads you're going to execute in 20 years? Do you guys know? I don't know for sure. Who could have predicted we would be executing the workloads that we're executing today? Okay, so this is the single cycle. You've seen that. This is just a reminder. That's how we got the 92.5 seconds. Okay, so let me give you... this is the multi-cycle MIPS FSM. Okay, what is the shortcoming of this design? I think we've covered some of this. But I'll give you one particular shortcoming. What does this design assume about memory? Well, I think I've already given you that also. If you look at the memory states over here, these two, I guess there's also one more over there, right? Fetch state. I don't know if there's more. I think that's it. There are three states, and they all complete in one cycle, right? That sounds bad. What if your memory takes longer? You want to also enable memories, different types of memories potentially to be plugged into it. So we're going to talk about how to enable this, and I guess I've already given you the answer. What if memory takes longer? Well, what you do is simple, right? Instead of assuming that memory takes one cycle, you basically say, oh, I'm going to wait for the memory. And let's see if this works today. There's the light. Well, that's an interesting workload also, right? So how do we zoom out? Do you see it? Autofocus. Wow, beautiful machines. Can you see it well? Well, what I'm going to do is not going to change much, but basically what we're going to do is add a loop over here, right? If the memory is not ready, you're going to go this way, and if the memory is ready, you go this way. Now you can wait for memory arbitrary number of cycles. And we're going to do this. And then this happens only when it's ready. And again, we're going to do this. Make sense? That's it, basically. That's how you can add memory to this. Now, why am I harping on this? How would you do this? How would you do this in a single cycle architecture? I don't know. Right? This, because fundamentally you're multi-cycle, right? You could add any kinds of transitions to your states that don't have to, that basically delineate the cycle boundaries or the conditions in which you would jump to the next state. Okay, this is clear, right? So this is the power of a multi-cycle architecture. Even though the performance results may not, that we've just seen was not good for various reasons with many caveats, this is a design where your performance can be actually much, much better because you are able to do that. Okay, any questions? Yes. How do you know that memory is ready? Excellent. You need to have a smart memory that tells you when it's ready. That's exactly it. And we'll talk about that later on. But yes, basically that's an external signal that's coming from memory. And when its data is reliable, it's going to assert that signal. When its data is not ready yet, it's going to deassert that signal. Okay, that's an interface between the memory and the control logic here. You could do that for any type of thing, right? We could actually have had the register like that as well, right? If the register file takes 10 cycles for some reason, because you have a large register file or have a very short clock cycle, you could do the exact same thing in the register read stage over here. Well, I guess over here, right? Where you're reading the registers. Make sense? Or the write-back stage, again, right? When you're writing the registers. You could make this, for some reason, write takes longer to your register file. And if you take an advanced architecture class, you will see that there are technologies that are emerging where writes take much longer than reads. This is fascinating in architecture. You can read a memory location much faster than you can write to it. Phase change memory is one example. Do you guys know about 3D XPoint? You may have heard of that. Intel announced it as an emerging memory technology that they're going to have released in the past, but they haven't released yet. But basically, in that technology, writes take about, let's say, 10x longer than reads. Your read may be one cycle, but your write to the register file, assuming that register file is implemented with some technology like that, takes 10 cycles. Well, what do you do? You basically add a loop over here, and you conditionally go to the next state, or you remain in the current state until the write completes. And the memory technology can tell you that ready bit. Well, the ready bit actually, there are two things over there. Right? Your question is actually good, because I didn't mean that it was bad before. It was still good before. But basically, you can be synchronous or asynchronous, right? Asynchronous means the memory tells you when it's ready, and it can be asynchronous to anything, to your clock, for example. Or you know that it takes this long to access memory, and you know that your clock is this long, so you basically wait for some number of cycles. Right? You basically have a counter that sets your ready bit internally. That's another possibility, if you know your exact timing of your memory. But you may not always know. And as memories get complicated, as we will see later in this lecture, and if you continue in computer architecture, as you will see, it's going to be a lot harder to estimate the amount of time the memory takes. Okay, we're still on the slides. Okay, we're going to go through another multi-cycle microarchitecture, just because I think this is really important for you guys to learn. We could have stopped here, but I think microcoding is so powerful, and it's going to be increasingly powerful, that it's really important for you guys to learn. And this is one of those examples that I provided yesterday, like the data flow, right? You should stretch your minds in thinking how things are designed. There's not one way of designing things, right? That's the beauty of architecture, if you will. Clearly, you see all of these buildings, and there's no single way of designing buildings. Just like here. We design the systems, and there's no single way. even with something like a multi-cycle microarchitecture. So I'll give you another way. According to Morris Wilkes, it's the best way, right? So it's I believe it's an elegant implementation also, but let's recall. Basically, we've divided instruction processing into states, and we jump from state to state to process an instruction, and we fully specified the behavior of the entire processor, ISA, with this finite state machine, and we showed that finite state machine, right? And in a state, control signals control two things, how the data path should process the data, and how to generate the control signals for the next clock cycle. Now, we didn't look at that control structure that much in the previous slides. You could do different things in that control structure. So we're going to focus more on this control structure a little bit. And we're going to talk about microprogram control. So we're going to call the control signals associated with the current stage of microinstruction. Basically, these are all the control signals that you need to control the data path as well as the control logic. And we're going to call the act of transitioning from one state to another, or determining the next state, and the next microinstruction for the next state, microsequencing. Basically, it's like sequencing. Instead of sequencing through instructions, you're sequencing through microinstructions. And we'll have a control store, which stores control signals for every possible state. Basically, this is the microinstruction store. This is the store for microinstructions for the entire finite state machine. How many microinstructions do you have? Basically, is the same as the number of states you have in your finite state machine, right? And control store will have that many entries in it. And we're going to have a control logic to step through this control store. We're going to call it a microsequencer. And this will determine the set of control signals that will be used in the next clock cycle, the next state. Okay. So this is an example control structure we're going to look at in more detail. Basically, it's a simple design, right? You have this microinstruction, and we're going to look at these, and you're going to read the appendices, so you'll know what these are soon. But some of these signals go to the data path to control the data path. Some of these control signals go back to the microsequencer. And remember, the job of the microsequencer is to determine the next state that you're going to be in, the address of the next state. It inputs the address of the next state to the control store, which contains the microinstructions. Think about this as analogous to instruction memory, but it's really a microinstruction memory now. So you get the address, which gives you all of the control signals, meaning the microinstruction, that you need to control the state, current state. So basically, you latch the microinstruction and then input these signals to the data path as well as the microsequencer. And microsequencer determines the next address and then gives you another microinstruction for the next cycle, and then for the next cycle, and then for the next cycle. Right. That's the idea. Have you guys seen this before? Who has seen it? Okay, good. So this is beautiful, I think. There are a couple of things I didn't tell you. There are these other signals that are coming from nowhere, apparently, here. But remember that ready thing? That is coming into this microsequencer, telling, is the memory is ready or not ready, right? And if you're in a state where the readiness of memory is important to determine the next state, the control logic, the combinational control logic in this microsequencer will take that into account and appropriately determine the next state address. If the memory is ready and if it matters to the state, how do you know if it matters to the state? Well, the control signals in the current state's microinstruction will tell you, the next state is conditional upon this ready bit. So when you're determining the next state, take that into account. Yes? What does it actually mean for the memory to be ready? What does it mean? Basically, it depends, of course, whether you're writing to it or reading to it. So if you're reading from it, you inputted an address and the data is ready. Meaning the data is out there and you can rely on it and you can store it anywhere you want. Okay? If you're writing to it, memory ready in that case means that it's written and now you can proceed with the next instruction. Okay? Okay, so there are other, basically this ready signal comes from memory. There are other things. This is the This is similar to what we've seen in the previous, I don't know if there's an easy way to switch between these things, but okay, this thing. No, not this thing. Oh, it doesn't show it nicely. Well, it's basically the opcode. Okay, there's an opcode over here coming into the control logic, right? It's basically the opcode over here. And this is called instruction register here, and it's LC3B ISA, which we're going to look into quickly. By the way, there's another function of this exercise that we're going to do. As an architect, you should be very comfortable moving between different types of ISAs and things like that. You know MIPS, hopefully, right now. Maybe you know x86, you're programmed in it. Well, if not, you will learn more about it in the OS course. But a lot of the fundamentals are always the same, and I'm going to show it to you with the LC3B, I think. That's why I'm going to cover LC3B in this in the rest of this lecture until we get to pipelining. But because the fundamentals are the same, you can take any ISA and any data path and hopefully look at it and make sense out of it, right? So maybe you don't get to that stage yet by the end of this lecture, but that would be my recommendation for you. This is just like some other programming language, right? Learning some other programming language. If you know one programming language, learning another one is hopefully easy. Not always, because it depends on the differences. But it's true for the ISA. ISA is essentially a programming language, and if you move between the different ones easily, that's good. ARM versus x86, right? These are two different ISAs, but they share a lot of similarity in the end, even though one claims to be a reduced instruction set computer, the other claims to be a complex instruction set computer. There are a lot of similarities in the implementation also. Okay, with that aside, let's jump into this a little bit more. Is this clear, the control structure? Now let me put it into context a little bit, actually. Let me skip this because we're going to get back to it. This is the context, basically. This is the control structure that I showed you earlier. And I called the microsequencer and the control store control over here. And these are the control signals that you get. So these don't operate in isolation. You get these 26 control signals that go to the data path and memory also. For example, we're going to decide whether we're reading from memory or writing to memory, depending on the state microinstruction. And these control signals also go to the microsequencer, and this is where the other signals come from. And unfortunately, this R is not connected, but it comes from memory. It should be connected. I didn't draw the figure. Okay, let's go back to this one. So what is the function of the control signals? Basically, as I said, the microinstruction, I'm going to call the control signals microinstruction, just to set the terminology. Basically, it's responsible for processing in the data path first. And second, it's responsible for the generation of the control signals or the microinstruction for the next cycle. I'm going to give you a supplemental figure with my drawing in a little bit. But data path and microsequencer operate concurrently. Basically, this control logic and data path operate concurrently. Remember, that's not clear. In the single cycle machine, this is not exactly true, right? You need some control signals to be produced in this cycle to be used later in this cycle. And that's one of the things that lengthen your clock cycle. Okay. So, okay, I think I've given you the answer to this also. We talked about this briefly. Why not generate control signals for the current cycle in the current cycle? Right now? Well, because this could lengthen the clock cycle, right? As I said yesterday, a general principle is if you want to generate your control signals, generate them earlier rather than later. Because you never know what your critical path will be later on. Again, this is a very fundamental principle also. I've seen this violated in real designs. But good designs don't violate this. Okay, so why could it lengthen the clock cycle? Now let's go to my supplemental figures. And I do this so that we save time, basically. I could draw it over there, but there's a switching overhead. This is like the latching overhead, right? So basically, this is a clock cycle, right? You have cycle n, n plus 1, dot, dot, dot. And at the end, you have a latch. What happens in a clock cycle is processing in the data path for this cycle, like if you're doing an ALU operation, you do the ALU operation, and generation of the control signals for the next cycle. Right? I'm harping on this because I think it's important. Basically, generate the control signals for cycle n plus 1, not cycle n. And at the end of the clock cycle, you latch the results of the current cycle N in the microarchitectural registers, and you latch the control signals needed for the next cycle, cycle N plus 1, over here. Make sense? In the microinstruction. Okay? So this is a good clock cycle. Now you have the full clock cycle to use those control signals. You don't need to wait for any control signal, except for some control signals that may need to be generated in that clock cycle. But we may take a look at that. So the bad one, the alternative is this. It's a long clock cycle, right? You generate the control signals for this cycle N, and you also do processing for data path for this cycle N. But this step one is dependent on step zero. Not always, but some control signals are required for here, right? And if step zero takes non-zero amount of time, which it does, in general, your clock cycle increases unnecessarily. And it basically violates the critical path design principle that we discussed yesterday, right? Now, this is not always the case, because sometimes your critical path goes through the data path, right? Not through the control logic. But most of the time, it does go through your control logic, actually. And even if it doesn't right now, you change the design a little bit, you try to save some cycles, and then before you know it, your control signals become your critical path, and you need to change your design. So it's better to start with a much more principled design, like this one, and generate your control signals in the previous cycle, rather than starting with this design and trying to fix it later on in some way. Right? So that's, again, this is a big principle. Start with a principled design so that you don't need to fix it later on, as opposed to starting with a maybe currently working design, but it'll cause you a lot of headaches in the future. Okay, now that we're done with my bad drawing, we can go back to better drawings. Is this clear? Excellent. Okay, we're going to do some microprogramming and have fun. But let's look at what other things are happening. Basically, what determines the next microinstruction? What determines the next state control signals? There are a bunch of things, and if I have a way of concurrently projecting this, this would be nicer. Does anybody know how to do this? No? There is no concurrent projection? Okay. Okay, anyway, I'll just jump back and forth. Okay, I guess at least I've placed these well. So what is happening in the current clock cycle clearly determines what will happen in the next clock cycle, right? Basically, you see the 9 control signals coming from the control block. These are the 9 control signals over here. Okay? Basically, current clock cycle control determines your next clock cycle, next microinstruction. Clearly, the instruction that is being executed has a bearing on what's going to be your next microinstruction. This is the instruction register 1115 through 11 coming from the data path. And whether the condition of a branch is met, if the instruction being processed is a branch, this is the branch enable bit, which I didn't talk about, but basically, if the instruction is a branch, and if you're supposed to take the target, this control store, let me go back to the longer control store, basically, this control store can either go to the fetch state or go to some other state, right? That's basically what it is. Branch target address calculation state. We'll see the finite state machine. Okay, and the last one is the ready bit coming from memory, whether the memory operation is completing in the current cycle if one is in progress, right? R bit coming from memory. So hopefully that one's clear. Of course, this depends on your design in the end, right? This is one example. In LC3B, when you read appendices, you will see that the ISA and the data path design affects what needs to be fed into your control logic. This is always true. Okay. So I've already shown you this. This is the so we'll also look at the state machine. This is where I really want the multiple things. How about that overhead projector? Yes.
So to walk this through, let's say we have an add instruction in MIPS assembly, and then usually in a single cycle state machine thing, we would determine the control signals from that one instruction. And right now we have to get these micro control signals
yes.
somehow. And where do we store them? Do we have like a separate program counter that steps through the micro?
I'm going to show you. Yes. You're thinking well. Basically, it's stored in this control store structure. And we're going to step through that. Patience. Okay. Basically, the behavior of the LC3B microarchitecture is completely determined by these control signals and the additional bits that go into the control logic from the data path. I'll give you the example. And the control signals completely describe the state of the control structure. Basically, that's all you have for this cycle. Okay, let's look at the finite state machine. Basically, we can completely describe the behavior of the LC3B as a finite state machine, just like we did the MIPS, right? We're going to do that now. And finite state machine is nothing other than a directed graph of nodes and arcs, right? And you should definitely read the Appendix C. And we're going to do the state encoding also, basically. But let me go to the state machine over here. So this is the LC3B state machine. It's a little bit more complicated than the MIPS that you've seen, but it's beautiful. Okay, we're going to do microprogramming, don't worry. You're going to understand all of this. But this is the fetch state, basically. Broken into, really, three cycles over here. This is the decode state, and basically the next state is dependent on the opcode over here. Let's see the add, that you, since you wanted add, right? Basically, if at the end of the decode state, the opcode is add, you jump to the state. And basically you did the add, whatever is required by the ISA, instruction set architecture for the add on the data path. And then the next state after that is 18. That's it, right? Basically, you go through these states to execute an add. If it's an AND, you go through this state, and the next state is 18. So here, the state numbers are also numbered. Right? This is state 18, 19, also 19. You can have the same state stored in different places in the control store. This is state 33, state 35, state 32. And these are actually the addresses of the microinstructions in the control store. If I show you the control store, nope. This is where I really need the multiple things, but let me show you the control store. This is your control store. It basically has 64 entries over here, and then 35 bits, 35 control signals, right? 64 rows, 35 columns. And this is what you need to program to make this machine work, basically. You fill in every single state over here. Some of them are unused, so you don't need to fill every 64 one of them. Yes?
It nowadays has, transforms their ISA into a simpler one.
Yeah.
It's the same as this.
Exactly. Well, I will not say that it's exactly the same, but it's the same principle, basically. And that's, say it again?
It happens before, then it gets
micro-sequenced this RISC ISA. What do you mean, it happens before?
Like, both things happen. First it gets translated into a simpler ISA, and then it gets micro-sequenced,
or micro-programmed. Hold back on that, we'll get to that. Basically, you can combine different different levels of micro-programming also. So, yes, the short answer to your question is yes. Okay, so we're going to go through this in a little bit. But basically, this FSM, this finite state machine, actually implements the LC3B ISA. And the LC3B ISA looks like this. It's actually pretty simple. It's more simple than MIPS. It doesn't have a lot of instructions, but it has some interesting instructions also. And I'm not going to expect you to know all of these instructions, but this is just for us to go through the state machine. And we already uploaded this. There's a revised version of it, Appendix A, that you can download from the course website. Okay, so let's take a look at the state machine before we actually do the microprogramming fun. How many cycles does the fastest instruction take? You can answer these questions just by looking at the state machine, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Right, everything has to go through decode, and the fastest one after decode is this one, right? 5, right? Excellent, yes. So it's not 5, I was wrong. It may be 5 if the memory is ready in the same cycle, so it depends on the memory, right? So it's basically 5, at least 5, plus extra cycles the memory needs to take, more than, if it takes more than one cycle. Let's answer these questions and then we're going to take a break. How many cycles does the slowest instruction take? Let's go back. And as far as I know, the slowest instruction is either the store load word or the store word, because they access data. Basically, you go through one state, memory access, two, three, let's do the load, four, memory access, five. Five plus two memory accesses, right? If the memory access takes 10, it takes 25 cycles, right? Okay. Why does the BR take as long as it takes in the FSM? So let's take a look at BR. It's a branch instruction, so everything is saying this is fetch, decode. You figure out it's a branch. There is a branch enable calculation that's done over here. And if the branch enable calculation is false, you go to the next instruction. Basically, you should not take the target. You should go sequentially. Otherwise, you do the target computation over here. It's not clear if this is the best design choice. This is, again, where you can design the things better. If this branch calculation takes really long, this might be a good breakdown of the states, right? But if this branch calculation takes really short, maybe you want to merge these two states, right? Does that make sense? Basically, if the branch condition is true, you need to store into the PC the target address that you compute somehow. You don't need to know exactly how it's computed, but you know how it's computed in the MIPS ISA, right? It's a branch plus offset somehow. PC plus offset. It's very similar over here, PC plus offset over here. Now, if this branch condition calculation, if you think about the MIPS ISA, remember we did the branch equal, you compare two registers. That could take very long, right? Now, if on top of that, after that, you also calculate the target, which should be done concurrently, but if the control signal latches into the PC, basically you might increase your clock cycle. In this case, actually, it doesn't increase your clock cycle that much because branch enable calculation in LC3B ISA is very simple. But just to make the point, you might want to merge these two states if actually both of them can happen in one cycle without increasing your clock cycle. It's designed this way in this case to accommodate potentially longer branch calculations. If the branch calculation takes too long, maybe you want to separate these two states. Does that make sense? Again, this is based on the critical path design principle. Okay, and what determines the clock cycle time? I hope you have the answer to that one. It's very hard to know by just looking at this, right? You really need to know the design. That you cannot answer based on the finite state machine alone. Basically, whichever state over here takes the longest in terms of the critical path determines your clock cycle time. And your job as a designer, if you're given the task of implementing this finite state machine, your job will be to minimize the critical path. But don't forget, this is just the data path, right? There's also a control. So there's also a control happening that's not shown over here. So the control could be your critical path as well. Okay, I think we should probably take a break over here. And once we come back, we're going to do some microprogramming.
Yes, sure.
To the last slide, you showed the diagram. Mm-hmm. You're only incrementing the PC count by two.
Okay, let's get started. We have some microprogramming to do, so. Okay, we're going to move to the data path. So far, I haven't showed you the data path so that I don't scare you. But it's a good data path still. And you should, as I said, please read Appendix C. You'll see that data path design. It's a single bus data path design. Basically, at any point, only one value can be gated on the bus or can be driving the bus. Do you guys know the concept of gating? No? Okay, we'll get to that in the context of the data path. But gating is, if you have a circuit, you can have a device that basically controls the input to that circuit. What drives that bus? So you have a bus, you want to drive it to the value, and you want to sometimes cut off that value so that you don't drive the bus with that value. Make sense? For example, you're taking the output of the register file, you want to drive it on the bus to move it to memory. But you don't always want to move the output of the register file to memory. Sometimes you want to put the output of the ALU to the memory. What do? You put two gates, if you will, that control who drives the bus. If you want to put the value of the from the register file to memory, you select, you ensure that this gate is enabled such that that output is driven into the, onto the bus. We'll see it pictorially soon. But basically, there could be another alternative, right? The alternative could be you could have multiple buses to communicate. But we have a single bus. Actually, I really want to switch here so that you can see switching overhead, how fast it is. Okay, it's not that bad. Can you guys see this? Oh, that's not what I want to do. Zoom out. Why is this so grainy? Autofocus. Is it better? Not so great. Okay. Okay, basically this is the bus. As you can see, it's huge. And I don't want to pollute this yet, but for example, this is the gate PC signal over here. It basically takes the program counter as the input, and the output is something that's dependent on the program counter and the gate PC. If the gate PC is enabled, the program counter value flowing through this wire is gated onto the bus. If the gate PC is disabled, this wire is disconnected from the bus. Basically, you have a high impedance state that disconnects this wire such that program counter is isolated from the bus and the bus doesn't get affected by that. Make sense? Same as over here. Let's pick the gate ALU. The ALU output, you guys can hopefully see it. The ALU output is the input to this gate. And if gate ALU is 1, the ALU output flows through this gate, if you will, and then it's loaded or gated onto the bus, basically. It drives the bus. Now, what happens, you see that there are multiple gates over here, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 that I can count of right now. Now, what if you set the enable signals of all of them? All of them. That sounds like you would get a garbage value on the bus, right? That sounds like a bad idea. So basically, this gating enables a simple design with a single bus, but you don't want to load multiple things onto the bus. Otherwise, you'll get garbage. Because you'll be driving the bus with this wire and then with this wire, and if they have different values, which they likely will do, you'll get the wrong result. So this gate, I guess for your future reference, it's really a tri-state buffer. I'll use this. If you've ever heard of the term, probably not. Tri-state buffer. Basically, for a single bit, it looks like this. This is the input. This is the output. And this is the enable. And you can draw the truth table for this. As you can see, there are two inputs, in and enable. And if enable is false, regardless of the value of the input, out is high impedance state. It's called high Z, meaning you're disconnected from whatever you will connect this to. And if enable is true, there are two cases. Of course, input can be true. Then you get output true. And input can be false, then you get output false. Okay? Simple, right? That's how you get the enabling or gating of the bus. Okay. Don't get scared about that figure yet. But it's a single bus design. The advantage is there's only one bus communicating across the entire chip. Now, clearly, that's low hardware cost, right? There are a bunch of other disadvantages, but we're not going to talk about all of the disadvantages. One disadvantage is reduced concurrency. For example, if an instruction needs the bus twice for different things, These need to happen in different states. And you may need the bus for different things, but hopefully at different times, right? So hopefully this will foreshadow some of the interconnect lectures that we will have in the future, basically. You can simplify the design with a single bus, but you always reduce concurrency in the system. If you need to do two different movements at the same time through the bus, well, tough luck. You'll need to serialize them. You'll need to do one first, and then the next one later. If you want more concurrency, more parallelism, you'd better increase your resources to have multiple buses. Again, this is very fundamental, right? Whether you have a single bus or multiple buses determine your hardware costs and parallelism or concurrency. Okay, control signals, as we've discussed earlier, determine what happened in the data path in one clock cycle, and we see the control signals, and we're going to look at them. Let me walk you over some of these quickly. Basically, this is the data path. It kind of looks like the MIPS data path. It's a little bit different because the ISA is different, right? The instruction set architecture is different. So you have a register file. Well, let's start with the program counter. If I can find it. Yeah, there it is. There's a program counter over here. Program counter, one of you noticed that program counter is incremented by 2 over here instead of the 4 that you're used to. Why is this the case? Well, because instructions are only 16 bits in this case. It's byte addressable, but you have 16-bit instructions. So that's how you can reverse engineer an ISA by looking at the design, right? This can tell you that you have 16-bit instructions. And program counter can be input from some other places, as you can see. The normal path is you increment the program counter, right? And you have control signals, like the PCMux control signal. And some other input of the program counter can come from this huge thing over here, as you can see. And that's basically how you determine the branch target address, right? And I'm not going to go through all of the potential combinations over here for determining the branch target address, because the ISA has multiple branches. But you can see that there are different ways of calculating the address, yes? No. So you're maybe confusing with the 35 bits for microinstruction, right? This 35 control signals, right? No, these are control signals that have nothing to do with instruction. So this PC is, so this is the instruction, 16 bits, as you can see. The microinstruction is 35 bits. Instruction, microinstruction, don't confuse those. Okay? Okay. So this is, let's take a look at some other portion of the data path. I don't expect you to understand this just by looking at it, but this is how you can look at a design and understand it also. Basically, you can see that you have a source register going into the ALU. You have another source register going into the ALU potentially. And there's some control that controls what else goes into the ALU, right? This is the first source register. This is the second source register. That's basically... You can do an add between the two source registers and then put the result on the bus and then load it back into the register file, right? And you see the load register signal. That's the write enable signal for the register and the destination register, source register here. But you can also add an immediate. So if you follow the path from the ALU going back, there's a sign extended result coming from the instruction register. Basically, sign extended last 5 bits of the instruction register, after you sign extend to 16 bits, you can add it to another 16 bits. You can basically select this and add it to another 16 bits coming from the register file. That's basically register plus immediate, or register operation immediate, because ALU operation can be chosen based on the control logic over here. So this is how you can reverse engineer a design. I'm not going through this fully clearly. But this is how you can actually figure out what the instructions are potentially in the machine, right? It's always good to think about it from multiple different perspectives. As a designer, you know the instructions and you want to design the machine. As someone else, you may be given this design and you may be asked to reverse engineer it, or for various reasons, you may want to look at it in that way. I think, hopefully, in your careers and this course, you would be comfortable in both, because both have very different types of values also. What we're doing right now is kind of reverse engineering. Okay. Let's see, what else do I want to point out over here? Basically, this is the address calculation adder, if you will. It looks complicated, but one way of calculating the address is taking program counter over here and adding to it some sign extended immediates coming from different portions of the instruction register. And these depend on the different instructions that we have in the ISA, which I will now show you also. Oh, wow. Okay, there it is. So basically, you can see that different instructions calculate their addresses differently. For example, for branch, you have the program counter offset. Oh, you can. Oh, yes. Sorry. Thank you. That's better, right? Slightly. Well, I have to figure out why this is so grainy, but hopefully you can tolerate it at least. Yeah, for example, you have the branch instruction. It says PC offset. It's a sign extended offset, sign extended immediate 9 bits coming from the bottom of the branch. And if you really want to understand what's going on, just like any other ISA manual, you go to the branch instruction. And the definition of the branch tells you how it operates, right? This is the address calculation. You take PC plus left shifted, sign extended, PC offset 9 bits, you left shifted by 1. And you take that target only if the condition is true. Make sense? Again, we're not going to go through the ISA over here. MIPS is good for you guys to know, but any ISA has this definition, basically. And if we go back to it, now you know exactly where this is coming from. This is a sign extended 9 bits. And then if you're executing in the state where you're executing the branch target, basically you would select this input, you left shift it by 1, you add to it the program counter over here, which means that you select the program counter over here, and then the destination of the branch, the program counter will have that as an input. Make sense? Okay. So it's beautiful. Once you read appendices, this will become much more clear. And you can see other address calculation operations. For example, load. Let's pick load word. I like load word. Load word calculates address just by looking at it, probably base plus some offset. Now let's look at that load word. LDW. Good thing this is alphabetical. Now, life is not as nice if you're looking at x86, right? x86 has 3 books like this. Maybe it's 4 now, and it's impossible to find anything over there. Impossible is an exaggeration, of course, but it takes a little longer to find the instructions. But load word, you can see that its definition is this. You take base register plus left shifted sign extended offset 6. And then you set the destination register to that. And there's also this curious thing, set condition codes, which you didn't have in the MIPS. But basically, this is the data path equivalent of this. Basically, this is how it's implemented in the data path. You take the 6 bits at the bottom of the instruction register, sign extend it, left shift it. And now, to calculate the address of the load, we saw the base register. So the other input will come from the base register. And the good thing is data path has a path to do this address calculation. And then you go through the MAR mux to load the address, dot, dot, dot. That's how the logic will operate soon. So the point over here is basically you can reverse engineer, you can correlate with the ISA, but there's one more point. There's this adder that's used for a lot of things, right? It's used for branch calculation, it's used for other calculations, so you can actually save a lot of space. By the way, this is not the minimal design also, as you can see. There's another adder over here. In fact, there's another adder over here, maybe a specialized adder, plus 2. So this is not a minimal design, if you will. In fact, that's one of my later questions. You could have gotten away with a single adder in this design, but the designer decided to choose 3 adders just for instruction purposes. Otherwise, things get very muxy. There will be a lot of muxes to control the inputs to a single adder, right? And potentially, you could design this plus 2 adder in a specialized way, right? If you know that you're always adding 2, you can make some assumptions that simplifies the design of the adder, right? You can minimize the circuits, basically. Okay, so let's... Yes?
Why did we not have a bus, or what was the equivalent to the bus with our MIPS?
Oh, excellent. That's a very good question. That's something I have not thought about as much, but it's a different design. That's my basic answer. That's the beauty of architecture, right? We designed it this way over here. You could find different buses over here, but it's fundamentally not designed that way, right? There's no gating, for example, happening. So you could think of this as multiple bus design, multiple point-to-point buses. So this is a bus, for example. This is a bus. All of these wires are really buses, but they're not used as a general-purpose single bus to communicate everything. Now, there are downsides to this. Now, if you go into the lower layers of designing a processor, this may be harder to lay out in the chip, whereas this may be easier because you have a single connection over here and you optimize that and you lay things around those. Now, you clearly have not learned that, but that's one of the reasons why you could go with this design. But basically, these are two different microarchitectures, and it's the architect's choice. Now, if you want to compare these two, if your next question is which one's better, that's a much tougher question, right? First of all, you need to implement the same ISA to do an apples-to-apples comparison in these two microarchitecture designs, which is not done here. But you'll need to really figure out, manufacture the chip. We can do a trade-off analysis, but that's not the function that we have right now. But that's an excellent question. Okay, now let's move on. So now I've given you an overview of the data path. There are also other data path elements that are not... There are also other data path elements that are not in this data path picture because there's no space in that. But as you can see, it's kind of similar to the MIPS data path, right? This is the destination register address. And destination register address could be these bits in the instruction encoding or register 7. Well, we have that in the MIPS data path also. And this depends on the ISA, basically. Again, another one, source register address. Depending on which instruction you're executing, source register address can be coming from these bits of the instruction register or these bits. And this is the branch enable logic. This is a different way of handling branches, and I don't know if I have time to cover that. All right, why not? I'll cover that. It'll give you another way of. So if you're curious about these things, there are two fundamental ways of handling branches in an architecture. And MIPS ISA, if you remember, you had this conditional branch instruction that calculated, that compared two registers. So branch equal instruction, right? It compared two registers, and if the result is equal, if the two registers are equal, then you jump to the target address. Now this is basically you look at the registers, and the branch does a lot of calculation. That's one way. Another way is using condition codes. In fact, one of the most popular ISAs, x86, has condition codes. What is a condition code? Condition code is a structure in the ISA, NZP. It could be NZP. Basically, that says the last result that was written is negative, zero, or positive. Make sense? Who sets the condition code? An operate instruction. If you do an add, for example, you set the condition code. In fact, I just skipped the load that I showed you earlier. This load instruction, this curious thing that set condition codes over here, it not only loads the destination register, but it also sets the condition codes. How does it set the condition codes? The ISA specifies that if the destination register is negative, you set N to 1. If the destination register is positive, you set P to 1. If the destination register is 0, you set Z to 1. And the other bits to 0 correspondingly. Basically, you can read it over here, right? The condition codes are set based on whether the value load is negative, 0, or positive. Now, what's the nice thing? This is called a side effect in an instruction. It's really not a side effect because it's specified in the ISA, right? Clearly, it's part of the contract. But it's called a side effect because the instruction is really doing load. If you think about it, it's a load instruction, but we're assigning something else to it also on the side. And the side thing is figuring out the value that's being loaded and setting a condition code based on that. Now, why is this good? Because you may jump on the branch later on. You may basically check that condition code and branch based on it later on. Basically, you've done this calculation while you're doing the load. As a result, you've set the condition code. The branch's job is now easier in the future. So if you look at the branch in this ISA, yes, the branch instruction, it basically checks, it's basically checking which condition codes are set. If you're checking N and the N condition code is set, or you're checking Z and the Z condition code is set, or you're checking P and the P condition is set, then you take the target. Now you can basically say, branch if the last result was zero to this target. Branch if the last result was negative or zero to this target. So you can do different kinds of equality checks. And the previous instruction can do the comparison right now, right? Or previous instruction can just do a load, right? So this gives flexibility to any instruction to actually set some condition codes, and you can branch based on that. Does that make sense? It's just a different way of implementing again. This also shows the diversity of the ISAs to you, hopefully. Now, we can go into the benefits and the trade-offs, but you need to take an advanced architecture course. Or you can think for yourself. It's not that hard, but we're not, it's good to think about it. We're not going to talk about the trade-offs. Okay, that's done over here. There should be a faster way of switching. Okay, so these are the control signals. You'll see this data path control signals in the Appendix C, and we're going to look at some of them. Okay, let's try to do some microprogramming. Basically, some questions on the data path. How does instruction fetch happen in this data path according to the state machine? Let me cover this one first. What is the difference between gating and loading? We've already talked about this, actually, with the tri-state buffers. But gating means enable and disable an output to be connected to the bus. It's combinational. It happens during a cycle with that tri-state buffer that I showed you earlier. Remember this tri-state buffer? Ignore the bottom. That's the tri-state buffer. Loading, on the other hand, it enables or disables an input to be written to a register. Basically, I'm going to use this terminology. Basically, this is sequential. At a clock edge, at the end of a clock, we're assuming that at the end of the cycle, if the load enable is set for a register, you enable the input to be written to the register. Well, I've already given you the answer to this question. So let's look at the instruction fetch in this case. Actually, I'm going to skip some of these. We've already discussed a lot of these, actually. And this is the control store. Yeah, I should show you the microsequencer and the control store so that we can go over it with just one shot instead of going through two different things. Basically, what we're going to do is look at how to program this control store a little bit for one instruction only. And if you're curious, you can do it for all instructions. In my advanced course, this is an assignment, but not in this course. And this is the microsequencer. It's designed this way. Basically, it gives you the address of the next state, right? And it has some of these bits. For example, this is the address of the next state based on the opcode, right? Instruction register last few bits over here, top four bits, because we have 16 instructions in total. 00 concatenated on top because we have 64 entries. So basically, if you're decoding, if you're in the decode state, you set this control signal such that the address of the next state is really taken from here. That's a special case for the decode state because it's a 16-way jump. If we go back to this state machine, which I can hopefully find, this is where concurrency helps, right? One screen, like a single bus, you cannot do two things at the same time on the one screen. If I had a concurrent screen, I could have done both. But yeah, I still cannot find the state machine. Anyway. Okay, basically, this is the 16-way jump in the state machine, and I will try to find it, because I like showing that. It's better. Where is it? State machine. I'm sure I had this before. Oh, okay, it's here. At least one version is here, because one is beautiful than the other. Okay, this is part of the chapter. Remember the 16-way jump? This IRD signal is asserted in that state when you're in the decode state. And the next state address is dependent on the opcode. For every other state, the next state address is calculated by this logic. So remember the J bits? J bits are unconditionally the address of the next state. So you basically put that into your microcode, part of your microinstruction. Unconditionally, these are the address of your next state. Now, if you're dependent on a condition that's also specified in the current state, current microinstruction, and depending on which condition you're dependent on in that particular state, you set these bits accordingly. For example, if the current state is waiting for memory, you set cond 1 to 0, cond 0 to 1, such that this AND gates becomes dependent on the ready bit. And based on that, your next state address is either all the J bits with this set to 0, or all the J bits with this set to 1. Does that make sense? That's the beauty of it. Basically, the only bit that's toggled is over here. This will become more clear soon. Basically, you fill this microcode that way. This is, as you can see, for each state over here, we have an entry. And for each state, we have the 35 control signals. IRD is set only when we're in the decode state. Now we can figure out where we are in the decode state. If I had placed this better, that would have been nicer. Okay, so the decode state is, as you can see, state number 32. State numbering is another question, but it's already assigned to us. That's fine. In state 32, basically, this IRD will be 1. State 32, you find state 32 and set IRD to 1. Condition is 00. It's not unconditional. It's not conditional because we don't even care, actually. Condition can be XX, right? It doesn't matter because we're going to select this one anyway. And basically, in the decode state, J bits are also will also not matter because J bits, we're going to select this one as the address of the next state, right? And then everything else, do no harm, if you remember. So we're going to do this in a little bit, but hopefully this gives you an idea of how things work. But let's do this for a single instruction. We're going to go through the decode state again. I think I've given you a lot of this over here. Let's do this exercise in microprogramming. We're going to assume these. We're going to go through the load word, which is a complicated instruction, perhaps one of the more complicated ones over here. And load word is this one over here. And we're going to assume this data path. And I think I've said this already, but a simple data path can be more powerful because you can actually add more states to it also, as we will maybe discuss. So let's together complete this. And hopefully I have enough over here, but I do need the state machine. I do. I guess I have almost all except for the data path. So I do need the data path also. Good. Now I found it. Okay, so I've extracted the state machine portion of load word. And just to show you which portion we've extracted, this is the state machine, and we're going to look at load word over here. So load word needs to go through all of these states, right? And we're going to write the microcode for all of those states over here. And remember, this is the microsequencer, and this is the data path. Okay. So state 18 is the fetch state, right? Oh, you guys cannot see this. Please shout if you cannot see. State 18 is the fetch state, right? And the finite state machine specifies that we need to put PC to MAR, memory address register, and then increment the PC. Why? In the next state, we're going to tell memory, give us the data at the address in the give us the data that corresponds to the address in the memory address register. Okay? But let's do this first. So go through the data path. Okay. Overlap a little bit. Good. So what do we need to do in this state? We want the PC to go into memory address register. Right? That sounds easy. For this to happen, we want to gate the PC, right? Let's do the gate PC. State 18 is this one. We want to gate the PC, right? Which means, oh, you can see it, right? Okay, good. Is red better? Red is probably better. We want to set this to 1. Now, PC is gated over here. It's going to flow during the cycle, and we want to put it into MAR. MAR is the memory address register. You don't need to know this complicated stuff yet. Basically, we want to load MAR. At the end of the cycle, MAR will be loaded with the PC. Now, what else? We want also a PC to have PC plus 2, right? As you can see in the state machine, the state specifies that. To be able to do that, we want to select this input in PCMux. Now, where is this PCMux? And we want to assign a value over here. Fortunately, the control signals are kind of nice, but I cannot find them. Okay. PCMux. This is where you look at over here. PCMux 2. PC plus 2. Select PC plus 2. We're going to assign 00 over here. Basically, this is 00, 01, 10. So 00 selects the PC input coming, PC plus 2 input coming into the PCMux. And we want to load the PC because our state says that at the end of the cycle, you want to load the PC. Okay, 1. What else is going on in the data path? Nothing else, right? We're done, basically. You guys can see this, right? Okay. So these are the only two things we want to happen in the data path. Everything else, do no harm. No harm means we don't want to load any other register. So all of them are 0. Do no harm means we're gating stuff on the bus. We'd better gate nothing else on the bus. These are the gating signals, right? Basically, gate ALU, gate shift, gate PC, gate MARMAX. We want to set all of them to 0 such that they don't drive the bus because PC is driving the bus. Now, if you make a mistake here, you have a buggy processor. Now, beauty of microcode. Let's say the designer made a mistake and set the control signal to... Let's say we made the mistake and we also did gate ALU to 1. In a hardwired design, this would be very difficult to fix. In a microcoded design, Intel can say, oh, I made a mistake in the design, so I'm going to ship a microcode patch. Right? So they can actually send you a microcode patch that basically writes with special permissions into this structure, this control store, and sets that bit to 0 instead after they figure out that they've shipped a buggy processor. So it's possible to do this in this kind of design, right? Whereas it's impossible to do it in a hardwired design. Impossible is a hard word, but it's very, very difficult. You need to design for it. Whereas here, it's natural. Okay, so just to give you another good thing about this. So okay, DRMux, SRMux, AddressMux, there's nothing going on in the data path, so these can be all X's. These are, if you want to know what these are basically different MUXs, but I don't have them over here. It's actually here. Yes, this is a DRMux signal. We don't care about these values, right? So they really don't care over here. Because we're not really using them in any way. We're not even loading the output anywhere. Memory IO enable, this had better be 0. This is basically the signal at the memory over here. Are we enabling? Oh, wait. Is it 0? Yes, it is 0, right? Basically, this is the memory IO enable over here. It enables memory. Ignore the I.O. for now. It enables memory for read or write access. In this case, we're not accessing memory, so it's 0. Read or write can be X because we're not enabling memory. Data size in memory can be X. And left shift is over here. Whether left shift is enabled or not can be X because we're not doing anything in that part of the data path. So we've written the microinstruction almost for state 18, which is this. But almost, not fully. Because now these are the data path, 26 data path signals. Now we need to write it for the 9 control signals, control store signals that will determine the next microinstruction. Remember the 9? We've just written this part. Now we need to finish this part. Let's look at it. It's going to be easy. We're in state 18. The next state is unconditionally state 33. Well, unconditional means We want to set the condition bits to zero so that microsequencer doesn't take into account. This is the microsequencer. We set the condition bits to zero. So unconditionally, we want to jump to state 33. How are we going to do that? We're going to set the J bits to 33. And we're going to set the condition bits to zero such that J bits take effect. And we're going to set IRD to this part, such that we're not jumping to the opcode, which is useless at this point, right? Basically, IRT is zero, and J-bits are 33. And if you tell me what 33 is, this is 32, 33. Got it, right? Now you've written your first micro-instruction in life, probably. That's our first micro-instruction, basically, and it basically implements this state over here. Now let's do the second one. Now, in this state, once we execute it, we've completed, and we'll jump to state 33, right? Now let's do state 33. I'm not going to go through all of this, but you can complete this. State 33 is interesting because it's conditional, right? And we still have some time. Good. So what does state 33 say? Memory will give us data and put the data into the MDR. So if we look at memory over here, basically, we put the address into the MAR now. PC address has latched into MAR. And we want to enable memory such that memory is read and the data that is given by the memory will be written into the MDR. This is a little bit more complicated over here, but you go through this over here. You don't need to deal with that because that's dependent on something else. But basically, the data will need to go from MAR will be input as address and then memory will be enabled. And the output data, when it's ready, will flow this way. Okay? Which means that we'd better enable memory. So let's go through memory IO enable. We're enabling memory. We're reading from memory. Our data size, so this is the interesting part of a complicated machine. Data size could be byte or word. Since an instruction is word or 2 bytes, our data size will be 1 in this case. Let me see, though. It depends on the encoding. In the end, it depends on what value you assign to what data size. So if you look over here, the data size, it's either bytes or words. Bytes is assigned 0, word is 1 sequentially, just like we did for here, 012 or 00010. So data size is 1 because we're doing a word. Left shift 1, well, left shift 1 has nothing to do with what we're doing right now because we're dealing with memory. This part is kind of not interesting to us at the moment. So left shift 1 is X over here. So everything else, do no harm. No harm. Gate PC. What is it? 0, 1, X? Do we want to gate something onto the bus when we're actually reading memory? We're not supposed to do anything here. It could be X, right? Basically, we can gate stuff on the bus, but we're not going to load them anywhere because all the load enable signals are zero. You're not going to do any harm because the registers will be disabled, right? So this could be X. Now as an architect, you have a choice, right? Do you really want that to be X or do you really want it to be zero? I'd want it to be zero because if I put it to X, who knows what kind of reliability issues will come up, right? That's one reason. The other reason is power. We have not talked about power so much, but if you enable the bus and if you enable lots of things to be gated on the bus, that's probably not a good idea, right? You just want to make sure that these are all zero, such that you don't gate anything on the bus and there's no activity going on, because power consumption is correlated with the activity that goes on in the design. However many bits you toggle, you consume proportional power. Okay? Okay, everything else, we're not touching it, so they're all X's, but you can optimize for activity also. Now let's look at the interesting part. What about the control signals that determine the next micro-instruction? We're not in the decode state, so we established that. We're over here. Now we are conditional, and we are conditional on this ready bit, right? The next state depends on the ready bit. If the ready bit is 0, the next state is 33. We're in the same state. If the ready bit is 1, the next state is 35. And they conveniently differ in this bit. Because somebody smart encoded these states. Basically, we're dependent on this ready bit. Our condition should be 0, 1, because we want that AND gate to affect the outcome. And our J bits are essentially 33 again, because the next state is 33 if the ready bit is 0. The next state is 35 if the ready bit is 1. Make sense? Because this is 0 over here. And only if the ready bit is 1, this will evaluate to 1, and you get 35. Make sense? Shall we do one more, or are you done? What do you think? Or do you guys get the idea? One more? Would one more help? I think some people it may help. Let's do one more then. But this is an easy one. That's okay. So now you can be quicker. That's the beauty of this. So the next state is it takes memory data register and puts the result into IR. So this is really simple, actually. We're operating on this part of the data path. We're going to load IR. Basically, we're getting data and loading into the instruction register. And do no harm on everything else, as usual, right? And we want to gate the data coming from MDR into the bus. Basically, we want to have this gate MDR signal enabled, which means that we want to have all of the other gating signals disabled. We'd better not gate everything else, anything else. And in this case, data size is 1, because we're still loading a word over here. You can see the logic later on, but MAR0 is an input coming from MAR, so you don't need to worry about that. So, and then left shift 1, again it's X. MIO enabled. Memory is not enabled in the state. We've already loaded the data into the MDR, so we're going to move it from MDR to IR, instruction register. So memory is not enabled, it's 0. Read, write, don't care, memory is not enabled. And everything else, again, they don't affect the outcome. They're all X's. And this state goes unconditionally to state 32. So IRD is not set. We're not decoding. Condition is unconditional. State 32 is encoded. 32 is written this way in 6 bits. Right. So it's pretty simple. You've just written another microinstruction. Right. So the next state, very, very quickly, it's very easy because here IRD is 1 because we're just looking at the instruction register. Basically, if you look at the microsequencer, if I can find it, we're going to take this part because we're in the decode state. And the address of the next state, here, it's all X's. Right? We don't care about what J value you input because we're not going to take that input of the mux. We're going to take the input from the instruction register that's decoded. Right? And the condition, again, X's, because it's unconditional. We're not dealing with this side of the microsequencer at all. Now, let's look at this part. Data path, there's something going on in the data path, which is branch enable, which is not over here, actually. Okay, it's here. Load BEN. Everything else, do no harm. Basically, I'm going to do no harm over here, and the mux signals can be all X's. And then we're going to do no harm to memory also. But these could be X's, right? Does that make sense? So you can complete the remaining 3 states. They're very similar, actually. You can actually complete the remaining 32 states. In fact, state 18 is the same as state 19, so that comes for free. Now you have a full microcode for this particular processor. That's potentially patchable. If you made a mistake, you could update it in the field if you have the software infrastructure to update the hardware. This is where we'll stop. We'll pick up on some of the benefits of microcoding next week. And then we will start pipelining. Okay, have a good weekend.
I didn't get why we don't write...